AP 120, Chapter 1, Topics, covering organization of, characteristics of, and maintenance of life. So, when we think about all the different things that can come together to form a living thing, it's quite a hodgepodge of all kinds of different things, molecules, macromolecules, organisms, organs, and all. But we find that it's easiest to organize this hodgepodge into a size, basically, breaking it up from smallest to largest. So we go from atoms, which is the smallest unit of matter, to molecules. We have multiple atoms bound together to macromolecules, which have thousands and thousands of atoms bound together. Many macromolecules can lead to the structure called an organelle. Organelles are tiny little functional structures found within cells, the cell being, of course, the fundamental unit of life. And when you get a bunch of similar cells working together, that gives you a tissue. When you have two or more tissues working together, you get an organ. And when you have a series of organs, glands, and so forth working together, you get an organ system or body system. And then when you get all the various organ systems together, you get the organism itself. So smallest to largest. So, characteristics of life. Well, what are the fundamental characteristics shared by all living things? Well, there's quite a few in our textbook. This includes movement. Living things can move both in their environment as well as internally. Things move inside of our bodies. And this can allow for responsiveness. We can respond to changes in our environment, external or internal. And also, often this response is related to movement, say getting out of the way of a car. Then we have growth. Growth is where the organism gets bigger. This can be from the production of more cells for the organism. This can be the production of extracellular material surrounding the cells. And this can be from the cells themselves getting bigger. So growth can occur in three main ways: more cells, bigger cells, and extra material outside of cells. And this is linked to reproduction. Reproduction, producing, on one level, producing new cells, so many of our cells are able to divide to reproduce in that manner. But also reproduction in terms of producing a new organism, where we produce sex cells, sperm or oocytes, and they come together to form a new organism. There's respiration. Respiration, the bringing in and taking out of air. And then there's digestion. Digestion, bringing food, nutrients into the body and breaking them down so the body can use them. Under respiration, we of course have absorption. The air we bring in, we absorb, bring in the oxygen into our body, into our bloodstream that our body needs to function. And with digestion, we also have absorption. When we break down the food into tiny molecules, we can then absorb those into the bloodstream. Oxygen into the bloodstream, nutrients into the bloodstream. And that's important because the blood allows for circulation. Circulation, movement of materials throughout the body, getting nutrients and oxygen where they need to go, getting rid of wastes and carbon dioxide. Then we have the concept of a simulation. Simulation is a change in the chemical structure, chemical features of a substance. So turning one kind of substance into a different kind of substance. This, for instance, can occur during digestion. We take big macromolecules and break them down into smaller molecules that we can absorb. And it can also be the opposite way, where we take those small molecules we absorb and build them up into new macromolecules that our cells can use. And then finally, of course, excretion. Excretion, the elimination of wastes. This can be, of course, the elimination of undigested material through defecation, elimination of cellular waste through urination, and of course, the elimination of carbon dioxide when we breathe out. These are viewed as the fundamental characteristics of all living things, according to our textbook. And these various functions are related to the concept of metabolism. Metabolism is all of the chemical reactions that occur in cells. So occur within the cells of our body that use or release energy. So metabolism, all chemical reactions in cells that use or release energy. And there are a lot of important chemical reactions that occur, and we'll be learning about a lot of them throughout the semester. Maintenance of life. Well, there are various things, quote unquote, things that we need, that most living things need to stay alive. So what are some of these things? Well, I'm sure one of them that may come to mind is water. We are mostly water, as 55, 60, 65% water. Water is important for us to function. It is abundant in our body, and most of the chemical reactions, metabolic processes that occur in our body occur in an aqueous environment, in a watery environment. So that is very important for the metabolism. And water, of course, is also a transportation medium. Things can dissolve in water. Water can move things around throughout our body, especially when we talk about blood. Blood is 90% water, and that's used to transport various important substances throughout our body, and also to transport heat. Water can transport heat as well. We are mostly water, important for chemical reactions and movement of materials. So, where can we find water? Well, pretty much everywhere in our body. There is intracellular fluids, watery aqueous solutions within our cells. There's the extracellular fluids, the fluids surrounding the cells, sometimes called interstitial fluids. And then there is, of course, the fluid in our blood vessels, the blood plasma, again, 90% water. So we have fluids in our blood vessels surrounding our cells and within our cells, and all of these are aqueous fluids, aqueous watery solutions. Another thing, of course, we need is food. Food is important. For one reason, it provides a source of energy, energy our body needs to function. Because again, metabolism involves the use of energy. We need to be able to make that energy. By breaking down foods, we can do that. The other important function for foods is, of course, as raw building materials. We break it down into smaller molecules we can absorb and then use those building materials to make up new macromolecules that our body needs. There's oxygen. We need oxygen. And why do we need oxygen? Well, that's pretty straightforward. Oxygen is used to release energy from food. So we need both the food as the source to burn and the oxygen to allow the burning to occur that then allows us to produce energy. Heat. Heat is important for our body, for our functions, especially for our metabolism. Various chemical reactions that occur in our body occur at, preferably at the temperature of body temperature, which is 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit or 37 degrees Celsius. So we want to maintain a body temperature around that set point. And this would then allow for the ideal reaction rate, allow for the chemical processes occurring on our body to occur at the speed that is best for us as living things. So heat, very important. And it is produced by metabolism, produced by chemical reactions, and also produced from muscular contractions. Pressure. Pressure is also important for maintaining life. Pressure means basically the force applied to something. And we need a certain amount of pressure both within and outside of our body. So for instance, atmospheric pressure, that is the pressure of the air surrounding us and how hard it is pushing on us. We don't really notice it because it's not a high amount, but it needs to be a certain amount for us to be able to breathe properly, to get the air moved into our lungs and then get the air released from our lungs by altering the pressure of the air within the lungs. So atmospheric pressure is important for breathing. The reason why people in climbing mountains like Mount Everest have to bring oxygen with them in canisters is because the atmospheric pressure at those super high elevations is too low to allow for breathing to work properly. And then internally, we have hydrostatic pressure. Hydrostatic pressure, water pressure, fluid pressure, the pressure of fluids pushing on things. And one place where hydrostatic pressure is extremely important is the moving of blood through the blood vessels. We need blood pressure, which is the pressure of the fluid, blood, in our blood vessels. And if it is at the proper levels, then blood can move throughout our body in a controlled and healthy manner. If it's too low, then we have trouble getting blood to move throughout our body properly. And if it's too high, that can lead to damage to the blood vessels, which can cause major problems. Homeostasis. Homeostasis is an important concept. It is basically the maintenance of a stable internal environment. So our body is constantly trying to maintain stable, constant conditions inside the body that are ideal for us to stay alive and be healthy. Homeostasis. And this system requires certain components. It requires receptors that monitor for changes both in our internal environment, say blood pressure, and our external environment, say overall room temperature. So we have receptors, structures that detect these changes. Then we also have a set point. A set point is the desired value, where we want our conditions to be at, so a certain blood pressure, etc. And effectors are muscles or glands that can respond to changes. So if the set point is not where we're at, the effectors are signaled to cause changes to return to that set point. And most of the time, our homeostatic controls are negative feedback. Negative feedback, meaning there is a change in one direction away from our set point, and we want a response to return to the set point. And so the idea of negative feedback is we are reducing the amount of change from the set point. And this is a very, very common approach. So here is our set point, say body temperature. If we get too hot, then signals are sent out to do things to lower our body temperature. And then if our body temperature gets too low, signals are sent out to allow us to return to the ideal body temperature. So again, we are going from changes that are going away from our set point and trying to cause responses to return to the set point. So again, with body temperature, we have receptors in our skin and other organs to detect when our body temperature is getting too high. This information gets sent to the control center in the brain. The brain then compares our body temperature to the ideal temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. And if we are, say, too high, say we're 39 degrees Celsius, then it causes effectors to respond. Blood vessels in the skin will dilate, increasing blood flow to the skin, allowing heat to be lost through the skin. Sweat glands will activate, producing sweat, and the water will evaporate, pulling heat away from the body, hopefully returning us back to 37 degrees Celsius. Positive feedback mechanisms do exist in our body, but they are rare because they can cause problems. They can be unstable. So positive feedbacks are moving further away from the set point. The two examples include birth, childbirth. The contractions become faster and stronger and faster and stronger until the infant is expelled from the female's body, and blood clots causing more and more regions of the blood to clot and get bigger and bigger until it finally stops the blood loss. So those are two forms of positive feedback. And that is it for this part of the Chapter 1 lectures.